SpaceX CEO Elon Musk has reiterated plans for Starship to take over Starlink launches, eventually fully replacing Falcon 9's role in the constellation. Since dedicated Starlink launches began in May 2019, Musk, COO and President Gwynne Shotwell, and a few other SpaceX officials and executives, have made it clear that the company would ultimately transition the task of launching and maintaining the Starlink constellation from Falcon 9 to Starship. In this video, we are going to look, SpaceX CEO Elon Musk says, Starship will take over Starlink launches eventually fully replacing Falcon 9's role. We are also going to look at, NASA Exploration Ground System starts Artemis 1 SLS core stage stacking. Barring major surprises, Starship is being designed to be fully and rapidly reusable from the ground up, nominally making the system far cheaper to launch. After Musk announced a radical redesign that replaced carbon composite structures with simple steel, Starship may even be far cheaper to build than Falcon 9 or Falcon Heavy, despite being several times larger, heavier, more powerful, and more capable. Despite its relative shortcomings, though, Falcon 9 has become an extraordinarily reliable and available workhorse for SpaceX, and has completed 28 operational Starlink launches, delivering -1670 satellites to orbit, since November 2019. However, while Falcon 9 has done and continues to do an extraordinary job of routinely launching satellites and astronauts, Starship promises to blow it out of the water. It might be several years before Starship is deemed safe and reliable enough to launch humans, but SpaceX could feasibly start launching Starlink satellites on the rocket almost as soon as it begins orbital flight tests. Thanks to the low cost of each Starlink satellite, likely now around $250,000, it would be surprising if SpaceX didn't include at least a few dozen satellites in the early phases of orbital Starship flight tests, even if success is far from guaranteed. At some point, though, and perhaps quite quickly, Starship will safely make it to orbit, re-enter, and touch down beside a Super Heavy booster a few times in a row, effectively demonstrating fitness to launch uncrewed payloads. It could take a bit more proof to convince paying customers, with satellites worth tens to hundreds of millions of dollars, to entrust launch contracts to Starship, but SpaceX itself, likely to be the builder and owner of the world's largest satellite constellation. For the indefinite future, has more flexibility to tailor its appetite for caution. With the capabilities Starship could feasibly offer, SpaceX might also be hard-pressed to just sit and wait. Speaking at a conference in October 2019, Gwynne Shotwell revealed that a single Starship would be able to launch up to 400 Starlink satellites, approximately 106,000 kilograms, 230,000 pounds, at a time, equivalent to more than 6.5 dedicated Falcon 9 missions. Unofficial renders imagining the payload have made it clear that more than 300 satellites could fit inside Starship's truly cavernous fairing with ease. Simply put, even if early Starship launches somehow end up being 5 times more costly than a partially expendable Falcon 9, that is greater than $75 million, the per-satellite launch cost of Starlink missions would be no worse than Falcon, while simultaneously delivering several times more satellites to orbit. In reality, unless SpaceX has to expend an entire ship, booster, and approximately 35 Raptor engines, the total cost of a Starship launch could already be cheaper than Falcon 9, even before factoring in the cost per Starlink satellite. Even with a downright tranquil monthly launch cadence, a year of 300 satellite Starlink mission on Starship would more than double what Falcon 9 has managed with 28 launches in the last approximately 20 months. SpaceX is unlikely to be ready to support truly operational Starship Starlink launches, or risk $75 to 100 million of satellites, until sometime next year, but it's safe to say that the wait will be worth it. On June 8, the U.S. Senate passed a $250 billion U.S. Innovation and Competition Act funding bill to support American technology advancement and science research. The bill allocates $10 billion for NASA. The bill includes an award for SpaceX's Starship lunar lander development under the Artemis program that is dedicated to returning astronauts to the moon by 2024. The funding bill now needs to be approved by the U.S. House of Representatives. The funding includes a $2.9 billion contract NASA awarded to SpaceX on April 16 to develop a human landing system, HLS. Under the HLS contract, SpaceX will develop a lunar-optimized Starship, capable of landing astronauts and cargo on the lunar surface. NASA selected SpaceX out of a pair of companies that also submitted lunar lander proposals, Dynetics and the National Team, led by Blue Origin. When the agency only selected SpaceX to develop a lunar lander, Dynetics and the National Team filed protests with the U.S. Government Accountability Office, claiming that there was flaws with the selection process, and that NASA should have picked two companies as it initially planned. However, the agency was unable to select more than one company, because the funding Congress initially provided was only enough to support the development of one spacecraft. If the U.S. House of Representatives chamber approves the $10 billion bill for NASA, the agency might select another company to join SpaceX in developing a lunar landers. The U.S. Innovation and Competitiveness Act, which includes the NASA Authorization Bill, is an investment in scientific research and technological innovation that will help ensure the U.S. continues to lead in space, and sets us on a path to execute many landings on the Moon, in this decade. NASA Administrator Bill Nelson stated, after the U.S. Senate passed the bill on Tuesday, I applaud the Senate passage of the bill and look forward to working with the House to see it passed into law, he said. SpaceX is already working on the development of the Starship launch vehicle, at its Starbase facility located in South Texas. Engineers aim to develop a reusable spacecraft, capable of transporting 100 passengers or 100 tons of cargo to space destinations. SpaceX is the only company with a human landing system proposal capable of launching to orbit, towards the Moon. Dynetics and the National Team are only developing lunar landers that will require another rocket to launch towards our celestial neighbor. After a month of thermal protection system foam repairs and other preparations, workers with NASA's Exploration Ground Systems and Prime Test Operations and Support Contractor, Jacobs at the Kennedy Space Center in Florida started lift operations. On the Space Launch System, SLS, core stage, for Artemis 1 in the Vehicle Assembly Building on June 10. Early on June 11, two of the overhead cranes in the VAV rotated the core stage from horizontal to vertical in the transfer aisle. Work will continue over the weekend of June 12 to 13 to lift the stage up into High Bay 3, position it in between the two SLS boosters already stacked, on Mobile Launcher 1, and bolt them together. The first flight SLS core stage was finally rotated to its vertical launch orientation, at KSC early on the morning of June 11. It was expected to be lifted from the transfer aisle up towards the ceiling of the VAV and then over into High Bay 3, to be lowered into place between the two SLS solid rocket boosters, stacked on the mobile launcher. Stacking of the core and boosters is be a big milestone in any SLS launch campaign, but work on all the other Artemis 1 flight hardware at KSC was delayed, waiting for this core stage lift and eventual mate, increasing its significance in even this first launch processing flow. Once the mate is completed, the core boosters, partial stack, will allow the EGS and Jacobs integrated operations team to branch out on parallel work activities to fully stack the rest of the vehicle, conduct special first-time tests, and finish pre-launch checkouts. The SLS core stage was the final element to arrive for launch, completing its special green run design verification campaign in April, and arriving at KSC later that same month. Following the full duration test firing of the stage in the B-2 test stand at Stennis on March 18, some post-green run refurbishment work was deferred until after the core was shipped to Florida. Standard post-firing refurbishment of the four RS-25 core stage engines was completed at Stennis, but work to refurbish the stage's foam insulation for its cryogenic propellant tanks and the foil and cork heat protection around the base heat shield were deferred to KSC. After 4 weeks of thermal protection system refurbishment work, and standard post-arrival preparations, scaffolding around the stage was removed, purges were disconnected, and self-propelled motorized transporters were used to move the carriers. With the core stage on board north in the transfer aisle, on June 6, to the area in between the VAV's high bays, to prepare for dual crane operations to reorient the core from horizontal to vertical, and then lift it into High Bay 3 for mating to the boosters. A lift spider was again attached to the front of the core stage the next day on June 7. The approximately 20-ton, yellow lifting fixture is identical to another unit that stayed attached to the stage at Stennis for the whole Green Run campaign. The fixture provides the forward lifting point for the stage. Once the stage was moved into the north transfer aisle, it had been expected that the team would press into lift operations. However, completing all TPS repair work delayed the final lift. Delays were anticipated during this first time through launch vehicle and spacecraft integration process for Artemis 1, an EGS planned for the work to take a risk assessed, 10 months to complete once the core stage arrived at KSC. EGS assessed as much as 4 months of risk, to a schedule showing 6 months of work, the current no earlier than net date for launch readiness is late November. But going through the first time learning curves, and accumulating delays of a few days, here and there is more likely to push launch readiness into early 2022. The fully, risk assessed, launch readiness date is March 2022. After the additional TPS work was completed in the north transfer aisle, lift preparations resumed on June 9, with the connection of the two cranes, to raise the core stage off its transportation carrier. One of the two 325-ton VAV cranes was attached to the lift spider, and the 175-ton transfer aisle crane was hooked up, to lift points on the structural ring of the stage's engine section. After the lift started on June 10, with the cranes taking up the load of the core stage from its carrier pieces, workers performed a breakover operation early on the morning of June 11, to rotate the stage vertical, where it could be controlled by the single 325-ton crane on top. The trailing lifting fixture and crane were disconnected. The next major step will be to lift the stage up into the diaphragm, opening between the transfer aisle and the high bay 3 integration cell. Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, make sure to subscribe. If you have any crazy ideas about what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we'll see if we can get to it. So thanks again for watching and goodbye.